Well, the AIM-listed resource company MX Oil is developing assets, primarily in Mexico, but now in Nigeria as well. And the executive chairman, or non-executive chairman, is Andrew Frangos, and he joins us now. MX Oil, bit of a giveaway. It suggests that you are involved in Mexico. Tell us about what you see as your biggest asset there, and why Mexico? Because it is a challenging environment to do business.
It is. Mexico has been a closed market for the last 76 years, and the energy reform in Mexico is to open up the market to foreign investment. So we've positioned MX Oil to be an early mover, one of the first movers into that country, and to participate in the first bid round that the government is running. So therein lies the opportunity. We're in a frontier market, and there's risk in that, but there's also a big reward for the early movers.
Yeah, so an early mover, what's the appeal though? Is it just the low cost? Because, you know, the price is languishing. I was reading reports about, you know, you're seeing oil just sort of lying on the surface. So it's relatively easy to get to. That's one good thing, it's low cost. But let's face it, the licensing round was a bit of a shambles.
Certainly, I think the interest in Mexico hasn't translated into bids. We've seen, for example, in the onshore conventional round, which we're participating in, the likes of Chevron, Shell participating, or at least getting into the data room. It's not necessarily the case that these companies are going to be bidding for those assets. I mean, these companies need material assets that move the needle as far as their market caps are concerned. And what's material for them, or what's not material for them, may well be very material for us. So I think the fact that there's not been as much interest so far on the early stage bid rounds doesn't take away the attractiveness to a company of our size.
So just to recap, what is your interest? What have you got so far? And where do you go from here in Mexico?
Currently, our progress in Mexico has been engaging with a local partner, very well-established service provider in Geostratos. They've been in country for 20 years, servicing the likes of Pemex and Petrofac and others. And when it comes to onshore, they're probably best placed, as well placed as anyone. And we're very fortunate to have that relationship. The focus for MX Oil is onshore conventional, and the areas that we are targeting are areas that our partner knows exceptionally well. So our advantage is information, knowledge, and experience. Mm. And our team is made up of long-standing Geostratos members, but also people that have actually worked for Pemex on these assets historically. So I think we've got one of the best teams in place in country.
So you're working on it. What does that mean? Give us the timeline.
The bid rounds that we're participating in get awarded this December. So the 15th of December, if we're successful in our bids, we'll be awarded assets, which will be announced at that time, and then you'll take delivery of those assets at the end of Q1, early Q2 next year. So our focus is that by around April, May time next year, we would expect to be producing out of both Nigeria and also Mexico.
Right. Okay, so Mexico is the main focus, and that's why it's called MX Oil.
Absolutely.
A bit of a giveaway.
Yeah. Yep.
So in that case, with this timeline you've got for Mexico happening, why the sudden interest in Nigeria? Because you've just bought, you just actually spudded a well this week. In Nigeria. What's all that about? That's a real shift of focus.
It's a fair question. We're looking to develop an E&P company. That means exploration and production. And in order to take advantage of the Mexican opportunity, you need access to capital. One way of accessing capital is through the equity markets or debt or through cash flow. In Nigeria, we saw an opportunity to acquire or invest very cheaply into an asset that wouldn't take up our focus because we are a pure investor into the asset. We're not operator. It's an indirect investment. And that investment, we believe, will yield a multiple of the funds that we put into it. So it's a strategic play where we believe that this investment will generate the cash flow that we can then recycle into the Mexican opportunity.
So just run us through the mechanism whereby it is going to generate that cash flow. Because basically you have, it's quite complicated, but you've taken on some of the debt, the Jaca, who have been developing it. They've got a deal for 5% of the revenue. How much of that do you get, and what do you have to put in the game?
Jaca acquired their interest for $16 million. They subsequently invested a further 10 million Australian dollars into CapEx, developing the asset. That $10 million investment went into the asset via a loan. So what we're doing is we're acquiring that receivable. That money is owed back to JACA. It's now owed back to us. So it is an asset to us rather than a liability. What we need to do is fund the rest of the capital required to bring this asset into production, which is approximately a further $10 million. And so that's why we went and raised the £6 million equity that we announced a couple of weeks ago.
And as a result, you get their 5% revenue from this is going to come directly to you. When's it going to come? And is this based on some pretty ambitious assumptions about the level of production? I mean, you're talking about 19,000 barrels a day by 2018. Some people are suggesting that looks a bit ambitious.
The development is over three phases. The first phase is two wells, which have been drilled as we speak. One of them has been drilled now. The next well will be drilled in about 70 days from now. Phase two is a further two wells being drilled. Phase one brings on a targeted production of 11,000 barrels per day. That number is from our competent persons report, and that's based on our 2P numbers. So these are not fanciful estimates. These are estimates from an independent party that's actually run the model. Our cash flow is set to commence from either December this year or January next year. So there isn't a long time to wait before we start seeing net cash flowing back into the vehicle into which we've invested.
And how much net cash are you looking at, and how much of that will go towards Mexico?
It depends very much on oil price. Obviously, oil price is depressed at the moment, and people can make their own assumptions as to where the oil price will be over 2016 to 2020. But the cash flow that this asset generates is starting from that point, and it really depends on whether we recycle that money back into phase two, or whether phase two is pushed back and those funds are then recycled into Mexico. If we do recycle that cash into phase two, so we go from two producers to four producers, that's how we get to the 19,000 barrels, and that's where the cash flow really starts to get quite interesting. And you're looking at net cash flow to us over the next 3 to 5 years of anywhere between $15 and $50 million, depending on your assumptions on oil price. So from our perspective, even if you are recycling all of that cash back into phase two, you can then access reserve-based lending against your asset and use that money to then finance your Mexican activities. So you don't necessarily need the net cash flow coming out to be able to generate cash from the asset. As long as you're able to produce the numbers, you can then access much cheaper debt than you could do if you were a pure exploration company.
And are you confident that the oil price is going to remain at a level where that scenario is realistic? I mean, it's sort of hovering around 6-year lows. Mm. And admittedly, all right, it's low cost oil. But, you know, I mean, obviously you are convinced because you just bought some more shares yourself. But one might argue, well, actually, if this isn't the bottom, all of a sudden, the mathematics don't add up.
The assets that we're looking at, both Nigeria and Mexico, are lowest quartile producers. So before we get to a point where it doesn't make sense for us, that means by definition that 75% of other producers have stopped producing because it's no longer economic. So from my perspective, oil price clearly day by day affects sentiment, affects share price. But if you take a step back, you want to be buying assets in a low oil price environment. You want to be producing and selling assets in a high oil price environment. And unfortunately, human nature is, when the oil price is $100 plus, everyone is then buying stocks in the sector, everyone's buying assets. And when the oil price is weak, people are shying away from them. The reality is, people should be doing the exact opposite of that. And that's what we're doing. We're taking a longer term view. What's important to our production and our cash flow is what the average price of oil is from 2016 to 2020. It's not that relevant where the oil price is in July, August, September of this year. It starts being relevant to us in January next year, but it's the average price of oil over the next 5 years that's critical to our future rather than the price today. And I'd much rather be investing when the price is low. and that's where the opportunities open up.
All right. Andrew Frangos, thank you very much indeed for joining us.
Pleasure, Nigel.